Okay, so excellent. Moving on and keeping in our vein of looking at nutrition and mental health, we have Dr. Kalila Bodden, who is the founder of Healthy Life Hack. She's a medical doctor, entrepreneur, evidence-based wellness consultant, and an internationally certified life coach. Dr. Bodden is passionate about helping others live a healthier, more balanced life through improving their understanding of food's impact on their body and boldly redesigning their lifestyle to suit their personality and beliefs. Dr. Bodden studied medicine at the Royal College of Surgeons in Ireland and proceeded to go on a journey to find out the exact meaning of true health. Since then, she has worked as a health insurance executive and started her consulting and coaching business, Healthy Life Hack. Grateful for the opportunity to help her clients create their dream lives while improving their health through food, Dr. Bodden makes sure to stay abreast of the ever-emerging medical research supporting the symbiotic relationship between food and health. This morning, Dr. Bodden is going to speak to us about junk food, fun food, or toxic temptress. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Kalila Bodden.
Welcome everyone to day three of the Cayman Islands Healthcare Conference, Food for Thought, hosted by the Ministry of Health. My name is Dr. Kalila Bodden, and I'm a medical doctor, wellness consultant, and freedom lifestyle coach with Healthy Life Hack. Wellness has always been a passion of mine. It's actually the reason why I went to medical school in the first place. Wellness and health has a huge role, it plays a huge role in our life. It indicates how long we live, and it also has an impact on how well we live our life. Helping clients to achieve their personal goals and transform their wellness is what I'm all about. And health begins with the nutrition, so a lot of my focus is on the correct nutrition that works with your body and preferences. The evidence-based information I'll be presenting today is the type of actionable content that my wellness clients find eye-opening. My usual clients are professionals who are already pretty health conscious and are living a healthy lifestyle, but they're not seeing the body type or results that they want. And during client intake, we dive really deep into their exact eating habits and their lifestyle preferences. And time and again, a stumbling block that I see are clients who eat what they consider healthy based on the packaging of the food, such as low fat, zero sugar. But in essence, these foods are actually negatively impacting their health and their body type that they're looking for. And as we can see, marketing for foods has jumped on the healthy bandwagon, and they've really capitalized on the individual's proclivity for healthier food choices. And while this, in and of itself, is good, differentiating between actual healthy food and ultra-processed junk food that is marketed as healthy is a critical life skill in the 21st century. And as such, that's why I've made this the focus of my presentation, because informed individuals make educated and empowered decisions about their food and their health choices. Another reason I wanted to speak on this topic is because ultra-processed foods, junk foods, they are so prevalent and pervasive, not just throughout the Caymanian society, but throughout societies globally. These foods cross cultures, borders, languages, socioeconomic groups. And additionally, what is a common theme among these foods is the targeted marketing towards children and adolescents. And what we will find out is this has a direct impact on their current and their future health. I'd like to take a moment to let you know a copy of these slides will be available for you to download at the end of the presentation. So in this presentation, you will learn how ultra-processed food is made extremely attractive to lure you into eating it, the physical and mental impacts of ultra-processed food on your body, how to spot hidden junk food packaged as health food, cheat the psychological draw of junk food, and how to still have tasty treats with less processing so you can have your cake and eat it too. So this presentation is made for you if you are constantly tired, moody, or grumpy, if you've tried this eating healthy thing but still can't seem to lose any weight, you can't say no to office treats, birthday cake when it's not your birthday, or cinema junk food. You always seem to need an afternoon pick-me-up sugar or caffeine hits, and you feel guilty when you're eating foods that you know are unhealthy. So what exactly is junk food? Is it processed food, fast food, ready-made food, convenience food, refined food? There are a whole bunch of labels and names, and it can sometimes get quite confusing. So instead, we're going to simplify it, and we're going to define food based on its processing using the NOVA classification system of food processing. And bear with me, we are going to go into some detail, but it's really going to connect with the second half of this presentation. So in 2016, when the Decade of Action on Nutrition was announced, the United Nations acknowledged a polarizing matter relating to nutrition globally. They realized that there were over 800 million people who are chronically undernourished at one end of the spectrum, but there are over 600 million people who are obese at the other end of the spectrum. And both ends of the spectrum are suffering from forms of malnutrition, which is now defined as those who have insufficient food and also those who are eating too much poor quality food. Now, there are several guidelines and several food classification systems that exist, but most are pretty purpose specific. And there are many ways that food and beverages can be classified, and let's be clear, there's no one single perfect classification system that will meet the need of all the users. So some researchers believe that when we start incorporating food processing into food classification, rather than just using food groups, we'll have a more useful way of assessing and monitoring dietary patterns. So for the purpose of this presentation, we'll be using the NOVA food classification system for simplicity and inclusion of the levels of food processing. The NOVA food classification system is a system that classifies food based on the levels of processing versus just using food groups. This classification has been recognized by the Pan American Health Organization and the UN Food and Agriculture Organization. The NOVA food classification system groups their food into four distinct categories, and we'll be going through these shortly in detail because we need to understand the classification system in order to find out where junk food fits in. So the NOVA classification of food processing group one includes unprocessed or minimally processed food. So simply speaking, healthy foods tend to be minimally processed or unprocessed. They look like what they did in nature, and they contain fewer than a handful of ingredients. Natural foods include edible parts of plants like seeds, fruits, nuts, stems, and animals, mussels, eggs, milks, etc. Group one foods include fresh, frozen, or dried fruits, leafy and root vegetables, grains such as rice and oats, legumes such as beans, lentils, chickpeas, starchy roots and tubers like potatoes and cassava, meat, poultry, fish and seafood, whole or in the form of steaks, fillets, or other cuts, chilled or frozen, milk, egg, fruit or vegetable juices without added sugar, sweeteners, or flavors, flour made from corn, wheat, oat, or cassava, tree and groundnuts, spices and herbs, you get the idea. Group one also includes food made up of two or more of items from this group, such as dried mixed fruit and nuts, with no added sugar, honey, or oil. And group one foods can be altered by processing, like drying, crushing, grinding, refrigeration, freezing. But it's important to note that group one foods, there's no processes that add sugar, salts, oils, or fats. The second NOVA group contains processed culinary ingredients. These are substances obtained directly from, as well as combined in group one foods, or from natural processes like pressing, refining, grinding, or milling. The purpose of the processing here is to make the products to be used in home and restaurant kitchens, to be enjoyed and prepared in home-cooked foods or restaurant-prepared foods, and to make them varied like handmade dishes, soups, broths, preserves, drinks, desserts, and culinary preparations. Group two items are rarely consumed in the absence of group one foods. Examples are salt from seawater, sugar from cane, honey from combs, syrup from maple trees, butter from milk. These also include products consisting of more than one group two item, such as salted butter. The third NOVA group is of processed foods. These are relatively simple products made by adding sugar, salt, oils, or other group 2 substances to group 1 foods. Most processed foods have 2 or 3 ingredients, and processes include various preservation or cooking methods, in this case of breads and cheese, non-alcoholic fermentation. The main purpose of manufacturing processed foods is to increase the durability of group 1 foods, or to modify or enhance their sensory qualities. Typical examples of group 3 foods include canned or bottled vegetables, fruit and legumes, salted or sugared nuts and seeds, salted, cured, or smoked meats, canned fish, fruits and syrups, cheeses, and unpackaged, freshly made bread. Processed foods may contain additives to preserve their original properties or to resist microbial contamination. And examples are fruits and syrups with added antioxidants and dried salted meats with added preservatives. Essentially, group 3 foods are group 1 and 2 foods with added salts, sugar, oils, and some preservatives. So, group 4, the ultra-processed food and drink products. This is what most people would consider junk food. These are industrial formulations, typically with 5 or more, and usually many more ingredients. Such ingredients often include those used in processed foods like sugar, oils, fats, and salts, stabilizers, antioxidants, preservatives. And we should note, ingredients only found in ultra-processed foods include substances not used in culinary preparation, and additives whose purpose is to imitate the sensory qualities of group 1 foods, or to disguise the undesirable sensory qualities of the final product. So in essence, what that's saying is sometimes we're eating foods that are completely ultra-processed. If you were to strip out all the chemicals, it would be like eating cardboard. But because it's gone through so much processing, it's actually quite tasty and hyper-palatable. Substances only found in ultra-processed products include dyes, colorings, color stabilizers, flavors, flavor enhancers, non-sugar sweeteners, emulsifiers, sequestrants, humectants. Several industrial processes with no domestic equivalents are used in the manufacturing of ultra-processed foods, such as extrusion and molding, pre-processing for frying. So the main purpose of Group 4 ultra-processed junk food is to create products that are ready to eat, ready to drink, ready to heat, and liable to replace both unprocessed and minimally processed foods, such as fruits and nuts, milk and water, homemade dishes and desserts, and meals. And common attributes of ultra-processed junk food include hyperpalatability, and we'll be talking about this later, sophisticated and attractive packaging, multimedia and other aggressive marketing, particularly to children and adolescents, health claims, high profitability, and branding and ownership by transnational corporations. Examples of typical ultra-processed products are exactly as you see here: carbonated drinks, sweet or savory packaged foods, chocolate, candies, mass-produced packaged breads and buns, margarines and spreads, cookies, biscuits, pastries, cakes, breakfast cereals, cereal and energy bars, energy drinks, meat and chicken extracts and instant sauces, health and slimming products, and many ready-to-heat or instant sauces, and reconstituted meat such as chicken or fish nuggets or sticks, sausages, burgers, and hot dogs. So when products are made solely of group 1 or group 3 foods, but they also contain cosmetic or sensory intensifying additives, such as plain yogurt with added artificial sweeteners, or breads with added emulsifiers, they're classified here in group 4. So today we'll be focusing on group 4 foods, the ultra-processed foods. These foods tend to be durable, accessible, convenient, attractive, ready-to-eat products. They're also formulated to reduce microbial deterioration, so they have a very long shelf life. They're made to be transportable for long distances and extremely palatable, which is what we call high organoleptic quality. And they're often habit-forming. Typically, these are designed to be consumed anywhere, at fast food establishments, at home instead of domestically prepared foods, while watching television, at your desk, at work, in the street, or while driving. So why are we focusing on group four foods, the ultra-processed junk food? Separate to the negative health implications, which we'll be touching on next, ultra-processed food is rampant throughout our society globally, crossing borders, cultures, developed, non-developed, and socioeconomic groups. Multinational corporations have now achieved a level of penetration in food markets in middle-income countries similar to what they've achieved in high-income countries. And unhealthy commodities are highly profitable because of their low production cost, their long shelf life, and their high retail value. In a study published in the Public Health Nutrition Journal in 2010, the food purchasing habits of over 13,000 metropolitan Brazilian households were studied. It was found that there was a uniform and significant increase in the volume of ultra-processed foods that were purchased over a 16-year period. In this graph on the right, we see the bar at the top, which is gray, that represents 1987. The middle bar, which is white, represents 1996, and the navy bar represents 2003. As we can see from the presentation, between 1987 and 2003, across both lower and upper income households, there's a uniform and significant increase in ultra-processed foods. For example, there's almost 100% increase in biscuits and more than 100% increase in sausages. And there's over a 200% increase in soft drinks. The study also reported a conversely matching decline in group one and group two foods in these households. So a paper published in the Journal of Appetite earlier this year, the dietary intake of more than 33,000 individuals aged two and above from the 2004 Canadian Community Health Survey were analyzed. Using this same NOVA food classification system, it was found that almost 50% of all calories consumed by Canadians came from ultra-processed foods. And consumption of such foods was high among all socioeconomic groups, but particularly in children and adolescents. It was also noted that these ultra-processed foods were grossly nutritionally inferior to non-ultra-processed foods. So in essence, in both developing and developed countries, we have a huge proportion of our daily calories coming from junk food. Which leads us to the next question. How bad can this be? Okay, so now that we know that junk food, ultra-processed food, is eaten in high quantities across all socioeconomic groups and cultures globally, particularly with children and adolescents, how bad can eating this amount of junk food be? Let's find out. So ultra-processed food is considered hyperpalatable. And what does this mean exactly? Hyperpalatable food contain ingredients that are highly processed and are combined with other ingredients such as sweeteners, fats, salt, flavor enhancers, and caffeine, making the final substance resulting from this processing significantly more rewarding than minimally processed food. This is what causes you to crave that hyperpalatable, ultra-processed junk food. And it may also contribute to the controversial food addiction. So a study published in 2011 in the Current Drug Abuse Journal indicated that consumption of hyperpalatable food has been shown to encourage overconsumption, which accompanies other factors such as increased tolerance and elevated wanting that may continue to drive the eating behavior of food addiction. But researchers are still exploring the relationship between overconsumption, hyperpalatable food, and food addiction. Perhaps in the future, food addiction may join other non-drug addictions, such as sexual compulsivity and gambling. So back to the topic, why is ultra-processed food so bad? Regularly eating junk food displaces minimally and unprocessed foods. Multiple studies confirm that diets high in junk food means that minimally processed foods tend not to be eaten. Therefore, we end up eating a very high caloric diet, but it's deficient in our micronutrients, deficient in our vitamins and our minerals. Ultra-processed foods are also high in sugar, fat, sodium, and they're low in fiber. And fiber is important because fiber feeds the good bacteria in our gut. And eating foods that are highly processed tends to change the microbiome of our gut. Now, that's another discussion for another day. But suffice to say that our gut health is intimately intertwined with our overall health. So eating ultra-processed food negatively impacts our gut health and our overall health. Ultra-processed food also increases our likelihood of excessive eating. So we tend to eat more than we usually would have if we were eating non-processed food. For example, many would agree that it's a lot more challenging to binge on apples than it is to binge on Cheetos, which is contributed to by our next point. Ultra-processed foods promote harmful eating habits, such as snacking instead of eating regularly balanced meals, eating mindlessly while watching TV, and consuming a lot of energy in liquid form, such as sugar juices and carbonated beverages. Junk food also promotes chronic inflammation, which we will be talking on next. A multitude of studies from literature, ranging from specialties like Food and Function, Nutrition and Diabetes, Journal of American Society of Nephrology, Journal of Magnesium Research, and the Journal of Nutrition, confirms that diets high in sugar increase levels of inflammation. And diets that promote inflammation are high in refined starches, sugar, trans fat, and they're low in omega-3 fatty acids, they're low in natural antioxidants, and they're low in fiber. So what this means is that eating diets that are high in ultra-processed food, meaning eating a lot of junk food, displaces minimally processed foods that are naturally high in vitamins and minerals, and they promote chronic inflammation. So an interesting study published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition followed more than 79,000 women over a 28-year period and reported that sugar-sweetened soda consumption increased the risk of developing seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. So many people think of inflammation in terms of external signs like swelling, bruising, redness. But in truth, uncontrolled inflammation plays a role in almost every major disease, including cancer, heart disease, diabetes, Alzheimer's, and depression. And we'll be coming to that shortly. But let's be clear. Inflammation occurs naturally in your body with an acute injury, when you get injured. But when it goes on too long, it can trigger disease processes. And that's why researchers are now spending so much time trying to understand it. And we should note that the chronic inflammatory process that is very unhealthy is totally different from the classical acute response that we get from being injured, which is very healthy. Chronic inflammation also promotes plaque buildup in the arteries and increases the risk of heart attack or stroke. Chronic inflammation also increases the risk of autoimmune diseases, such as rheumatoid arthritis that we just mentioned. And chronic inflammation increases gut inflammation. And we did just mention gut health and its impact on our overall health. And chronic inflammation has been shown to result in inflammatory bowel disease. Chronic inflammation is also associated with Alzheimer's dementia. New studies are emerging to support the relationship between Alzheimer's and chronic inflammation. And as you can see from this picture, Alzheimer's dementia has a severe physical impact on the brain. And so to have this debilitating disease associated with chronic inflammation that is directly impacted by our diet is incredible. As one study so eloquently put, inflammation is the common link among leading causes of death. So what are the physical effects of junk food? What is it actually doing to your body? A diet high in ultra-processed food is a leading risk factor for chronic non-communicable diseases, such as obesity. So studies have shown that high fructose corn syrup found in a plethora of ultra-processed food contribute to overconsumption and therefore the obesity epidemic. Obesity has also been linked to mortality from the majority of cancers. Studies have also found that diets high in refined carbohydrates, which make up a high percentage of junk food, promote inflammation and offer a greater risk for cardiovascular disease and type 2 diabetes. In a study published in 2012 in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, followed 39,000 middle-aged Japanese men and women for 18 years, and they found that drinking soda increased the risk of ischemic stroke in women. Studies have also shown that the intake of trans fat, which many times are found in small amounts in junk food, is associated with increased inflammation and your risk of cardiovascular disease. So in essence, a Westerner's diet with high intakes of processed meat, sweets, fried fruits, and refined grains are positively associated with inflammation and negatively impact cardiovascular health. A study published just this month in the Nutrients Journal found that chronic low-grade inflammation plays a pivotal role in the pathogenesis of obesity and its association with chronic diseases such as type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, pulmonary disease, cancer, and autoimmune diseases. Because of this, researchers are now targeting inflammation as a potential strategy to counteract the ever-growing obesity epidemic and its disease burden on the population. A study published in 2015 in the Hormone Molecular Biology and Clinical Investigation Journal found that our consumption of sugar has dramatically increased over the last 30 years. Sugar has been shown to impact gut permeability and promote the release of inflammatory markers. So high consumptions of sugar have also been associated with colon, pancreatic, and liver cancers. So we've been talking about how junk food, ultra-processed food, increases our risk of chronic inflammation. And recently, it has been found that inflammation also crosses the blood-brain barrier and affects our psyche. So one of the effects of junk food is depression. With a diet high in ultra-processed foods, we displace the minimally processed foods that contain the good vitamins, minerals, omega-3 fatty acids, and fiber. Diets low in omega-3 fatty acids have been associated with depression. A paper published in the American Journal of Psychiatry in 2015 reports that a Western diet of processed meats, sweets, desserts, French fries, and refined grains promote inflammation and fuel depressive symptoms. And it's become very clear that depression and inflammation fuel one another. An article released by Harvard Health summarizing recent studies reported an increase in severity of schizophrenic symptoms and poor response in treatment to patients with chronic inflammation. Researchers are also querying whether autism and bipolar disorder are actually impacted by inflammation, and therefore, if they are impacted by our diet as well. So here's a little public service announcement. Before you diagnose yourself with depression, first make sure you're not, in fact, surrounded by idiots. And then check what you're eating. Because now we understand the impact that our ultra-processed food has on our body and our mind. And we are seeing literally what we put in our mouth, what we eat, has a significant impact on our quality of life. So what can we do about it? Let's find out. Step one. The first step we have to do is to identify what is ultra-processed food. What is junk food? How do we go about that? So you may remember from early on in the presentation, ultra-processed foods contain more than five ingredients, and sometimes, many times, many more than just five ingredients. In this example, we have a common breakfast meal that contains a multitude of ingredients that we don't find in our kitchen, pantry, or spice rack that promote inflammation and therefore increase our risk of mental health issues and chronic diseases. These ingredients include inflammation-inducing vegetable oil, artificial flavors, artificial colors, yellow number five, yellow number six, preservatives. In this slide, a popular chip snack contains inflammation-inducing vegetable oils, MSG, artificial flavors, and preservatives. In this example of a popular ice cream, don't know if you can read the ingredients there. Ingredients contain high fructose corn syrup, artificial flavors, margarine, partially hydrogenated soybean oil, mono and diglycerides, artificial butter flavor, carrageenan, which is a gut irritant. And it should be noted that this ice cream is advertised on the front, if you can see that, as always real ice cream. I'm pretty sure if you made ice cream at home, you wouldn't have high fructose corn syrup, artificial flavorings, or partially hydrogenated soybean oil. Another way to identify junk food is to check its packaging and shelf life. If it comes from the middle aisles of the grocery store, if it's in a box, if it has an expiry date past next year, chances are you're holding an ultra-processed food. Even gluten-free, vegetarian, fat-free, all-natural, and vegan foods are not excluded. Look at the ingredient label. So in this example, a light butter's ingredients includes modified cornstarch, tapioca maltodextrin, mono and diglycerides, potassium sorbate, sodium benzoate, flavorings, and artificial colors. And these have all been labeled as ingredients not found in regular butter on the package. So these are just chemical additives to this product. So as you can see, even foods labeled as vegan and what most would consider healthy is not excluded from ultra-processed foods. Vegan and vegetarian may be a healthy way to eat, but processed foods are found even in these diets. And in this example of a meat-free vegan hot dog, Ingredients include the inflammation-inducing vegetable oils, modified starches, and artificial flavorings. For those of you who eat a gluten-free diet, you still need to check the label. These gluten-free cookies, they still contain soybean and canola oils, which are inflammatory-inducing, high in omega-6, alpha-tocopherol, soy lecithin, and even artificial flavorings. My favorite. If it states healthy on the package. True healthy foods don't need to display healthy on its packaging. You don't see oranges or cauliflower with healthy displayed on its packaging. But ultra-processed foods use these unregulated marketing labels such as fresh, natural, and healthy as a way to increase sales. What I mean by unregulated, there are certain terms that are regulated, like USDA certified organic or non-GMO. That means that they have to be inspectors that visit these farms to make sure that they are organic and non-GMO. But when you see packaging with words such as healthy, natural, or fresh, these don't mean anything. These are free for all. So you'll see them on the most ultra-processed foods you can find. In this example, a healthy breakfast cereal advertises itself as lowering both cholesterol and blood pressure. But if we look at the ingredients, it contains high fructose corn syrup, partially hydrogenated soybean oil, BHT chemicals for freshness, and artificial flavorings. These are all ingredients that indicate that this is an ultra-processed food and therefore increases, not decreases, our risk of cardiovascular disease, contrary to the marketing on the front of the box. If it has a TV commercial, if your food has a TV commercial, it probably means that a transnational corporation with a budget to directly advertise to you during prime time or during prime watching time for your children are promoting their ultra-processed foods. Non-processed or minimally processed foods contain anti-inflammatory properties and improve health, but they're not really advertised on TV. When was the last time you saw a commercial for banana or radishes? Transnational corporations are the companies that have a budget for the aggressive marketing. Because processed foods have low manufacturing costs, long shelf life, and a high retail value. Your local farmer or small organic grower does not have the profits or revenue to be able to advertise their products in the same manner. So in this example, these French fries from a famous fast food chain, you would think would contain two ingredients, potatoes and salt. Instead, these French fries are made with over 17 different ingredients that make this an ultra-processed food. In this example, this famous granola bar is advertised as 100% natural, but contains ingredients such as inflammatory-inducing vegetable oils, high in omega-6, and high-fructose corn syrup, both which promote inflammation and therefore increase your risk of chronic diseases. There's nothing natural about that. So we know that ultra-processed food is tasty, hyper-palatable, convenient, attractive. What can we do about it? Well, we're not out of the running just yet. Here are some simple yet very effective tricks to help you kick those cravings. The first one, avoid the grocery aisle that tempts the most. If you know that you can't pass the cookie aisle or the ice cream aisle without stockpiling your trolley, just avoid that aisle completely and keep those foods out of your home. In actuality, it's better if you shop on the outskirts of the grocery store, because on the outskirts of the grocery store is where the grocer keeps their fresh, chilled, and frozen produce. The stuff that goes off, the stuff that doesn't have a long shelf life, the stuff that isn't ultra-processed. Shopping in the center aisles of the grocery store is where you'll find the junk food because ultra-processed foods can be boxed and they can stay on the shelf for years to come without needing refrigeration or freezing. Use real ingredients instead of fake replacements. For example, instead of margarine, which is an ultra-processed food, replace it with real grass-fed butter. Or instead of using vegetable oils that are high in inflammation-promoting omega-6 fatty acids, cook with oils from the group 2 foods, such as coconut oils, olive oil, avocado oil. Coconut oil, a medium-chain fatty acid, has been shown to improve cognitive functioning in older adults with memory disorders. Studies have also shown that the anti-inflammatory effects of real butter lower inflammatory levels, and produce a clinically significant improvement in Crohn's disease, a type of inflammatory bowel disease. And to be clear, a meta-analysis published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition in 2010 followed almost 350,000 people over approximately two decades. This meta-analysis showed that there was no significant evidence that saturated fat is associated with increased risk of cardiovascular disease. The processed foods that people perceive to be high in saturated fats are in fact loaded with sugar, refined carbs, inflammation-inducing vegetable oils, which are now implicated in being very pro-inflammatory and linked to heart disease, cancer, and dementia. So the so-called dangers of real butter has been debunked. Skip the processed stuff, go for the real fats in moderation. Another tip, be mindful of how you feel after eating. If you're feeling tired, lethargic, bloated, if you have stomach pains, if you have diarrhea or constipation, if you have acid reflux, or if you have any changes in mood, this is not normal. When you start feeling these symptoms, make a note of it. Use a journal or put a record of it in your phone of what you've eaten over the last 2 hours. When you start doing this for 2 weeks, you may start to notice a pattern of feeling these symptoms after eating a certain type of food. This could indicate an allergy or reaction to that particular food, showing that that food may not work for you or your digestion very well and may need to be excluded from your diet. And this is where we go back to that point that health is not a one size fits all. It's very individual, and what works for one may not work for someone else, and that's okay. I love this. Substitute, substitute, substitute. So in a perfect world, it would be great to say we're just never going to eat ultra-processed foods again. We know the detrimental health implications when we eat these types of food, from obesity to chronic diseases to inflammatory diseases and even mental health issues. But we don't live in a perfect world. Even though we know how negatively impactful these foods are, we may still even crave them from time to time. So a more realistic approach, rather than cold turkey never eating junk food ever again, is to substitute the ultra-processed food for another option that tastes just as good but contains better ingredients without the negative health consequences. For example, when you eat a hot dog, you're not just eating beef and a bun. You're also eating modified cornstarch, sodium phosphates, artificial flavorings, sodium diacetate, high fructose corn syrup, soybean oil, preservatives, and dough conditioners. So instead of an ultra-processed hot dog, opt for a healthier, minimally processed one that tastes just as good, or I'd argue even better, a grass-fed beef hot dog. Ingredients of this hot dog are pretty simple. Beef, water, salt, organic evaporated cane syrup, and organic spices. So you still get your hot dog, but without the processing. In this example, instead of eating inflammatory-inducing vegetable oils, MSG, modified cornstarch, artificial flavors, artificial colors, replace that snack with some plantain chips. You still get your salt and your crunch, but without all of those nasty ingredients. In another example, instead of eating highly processed candy, opt for sweets that have less ingredients and less processing. And as you can also see, the substitute is not perfect either. There are still one or two ingredients in here that indicate it is a processed food. And we go back to what we said. In a perfect world, it would be great if we never ate processed foods ever again. But in reality, substituting ultra-processed food for less processed, less inflammatory-inducing alternatives that are just as tasty really is better for our physical and mental health. So in this slide, on the far left example, we see that these cookies are marketed as nutritionally rich cookies. Yet they contain inflammatory-inducing ingredients such as vegetable oils and artificial flavors. Living in the 21st century with a global market available at our fingertips, you can almost always find a substitute that is less processed and healthier for us, such as these alternative cookie options on the right. On this slide, we see some very popular microwave popcorns that contain ultra-processed ingredients that promote inflammation. Instead of never having popcorn again, you could just substitute for another type of popcorn that is instead minimally processed and still tastes as good. And Buddha popcorn does come in different flavors, so you should check it out. Take this well-known breakfast cereal, for example. Even though the marketing on the box promotes whole grains with vitamins, when we look at the ingredients, we see that it's an ultra-processed food with modified cornstarch, artificial food colorings, yellow number 5, yellow number 6, blue number 1, and artificial flavors. So if breakfast cereal is your thing, substitute it out for a minimally processed breakfast cereal, such as this one with a handful of Group 1 ingredients. It's important to note that the brands and the marketing, they don't matter. Always, always, always just look at the ingredients. The ingredients don't lie. Eat and drink probiotics. So a paper published in the American Journal of Psychiatry in 2015 indicated that probiotics not only help protect the gut from damage of ultra-processed food, but they've also been shown to reduce depressive symptoms due to their anti-inflammatory properties. Examples of probiotic include yogurt, kefir, sauerkraut, kimchi, raw apple cider vinegar, and my favorite, kombucha. Play around, experiment, see what you like and what you don't like. You may even find a new favorite snack or food. Making your own food and desserts at home is really a fun way for the whole family to get involved in food prep. This teaches children important life skills of how to cook healthy and tasty foods that they can take with them for their entire life. Also, the food that you make is already naturally less processed because it's coming out of your own kitchen using real ingredients. But you may be thinking, I still want donuts. And that's totally okay. We just have to remember, kicking a craving is not going to happen in one go. We've been eating these types of ultra-processed foods for years, sometimes decades. So giving them up is not going to be that easy or that quick. But here are some ways that we can ease the transition from ultra-processed food to less processed alternatives. Don't give up your favorite fruits. Instead, try to limit the frequency of when you eat them. So if you like pizza, donuts, cookies, and hamburgers, don't give them all up at once. Instead, start slowly building the defense against junk food. So for example, on Mondays, maybe you eat healthy and you treat yourself to a slice of pizza. On Tuesdays, you do enjoy a donut. On Wednesdays, you have a few homemade cookies. The goal is to make sure that you're having a treat that you like every day, but you're not eating everything every day. For the love of God, do not go on a health kick. Cool. Instead, you want to eat mindfully and healthily the foods that you actually like. Eat in a way that you can sustain for the long term. Eating boring foods or foods that you don't like is a guaranteed way to fail at adjusting your diet. Eat the foods that you like in moderation. Have ice cream, have a patty. But like we said, don't eat everything every day. Do continue to enjoy eating. If you don't like mealtime, change the food. Explore new recipes and try new foods. Eating healthy should be just as interesting as picking up a pack of your favorite cookies. If it's not, then that's a sign that you may want to be eating better tasting and more interesting food. Healthy food doesn't have to be boring. It should still taste good and should be something that you look forward to. So try new foods, new seasonings, and new spices to keep it fun. Do get a buddy, partner, or spouse to join you. Temptations will arise. Having someone on the journey will help you succeed at each rise. A friend or spouse will also motivate you when sometimes you feel like slipping back into old habits. Having someone there to lovingly remind us of why we wanted to go on a health journey in the first place can be extremely beneficial. Do get a coach or mentor. We don't reach our goals and become great by ourselves. Every Olympic athlete, prominent business person, politician has always had coaches and mentors. The International Coach Federation, the leading global coaching organization, reports that getting coaching increases your productivity, builds self-confidence, and improves your quality of life. Coaching also provides accountability, addresses derailing behavior, and increases your levels of success in achieving your goals. The ICF reports that 96% of individuals and organizations who hire a coach would repeat the process because of the positive results and self-development that happens when you hire the right coach. So the next time you feel for junk food, take a moment to recall the effects of ultra-processed foods, such as obesity, depression, chronic inflammation, chronic diseases, inflammatory diseases, and see if there's a healthier substitute. Because remember for yourself, you are meant for greatness. You are stronger, smarter, and more resilient than you think. You are capable of achieving far more than you believe. You are meant for greatness. But it takes persistence with your new healthy habits. It takes determination to avoid temptation. It takes facing your fears and doing that which is hard and necessary, like making good food choices, instead of what is quick and easy, like ultra-processed foods. It takes skipping the mythical shortcuts, like fad diets, and instead using your imagination as a map and preview of life's coming attractions of the new and healthier you. So there are about 50 sources referenced in this presentation. So if you're interested in where I got my data from, please visit bit.ly/healthypresentation for the full bibliography. And if you enjoyed this presentation and you're interested in finding how you can take your personal wellness to the next level, please do visit bit.ly/healthypresentation for more information. And if you'd like a copy of these slides for your own reference or to share, please visit the URL as well, and you'll be able to download the link. Thank you. Are there any questions at all?
We have time for one or two questions before the break. If I can get a mic runner to run a mic.
Sorry,
we've got a mic. Dr. Veit, just a sec. We've got.